As film lovers, we have our traditions, and one of them is to list the best and worst movies of the year. So as 2021 comes to a close, let's do that. This is my best list, and my worst list will be a separate video, which should be up shortly. And when it's up, I'll put a link down below at the top of the comments. Now, the rules. Some of you might be like, why is this movie that I love not on your list? Well, it might be because I didn't love it as much as you, but it might also be because it doesn't fit the rules. One, the film has to be in this year's awards window. I'm not going by the calendar year. This particularly appeals, this list, that rule is particularly for my overseas friends because you have different release dates. So in the past, you've been like, I love this movie that came out in January. That's last year. That's a last year movie. And then also, it has to have played in theaters. I don't care if it had a digital component, but it has to have played in theaters, even for a couple of days. I'm looking at you, Netflix. I do have a Netflix movie on this list. All right, I'm looking forward to hearing your own lists down below. And before we get started, I just want to say, hey, take a moment and make sure you're subscribed. We have a whole year coming up ahead of us of new movies and TV that we're going to want to discuss together. Oh, it's going to be fun. And speaking of fun, let's do this, my top 10 movies of 2021. Number 10, The Kingsman. That's right, this is my list. I'll put on it what I want. And if you are wondering why The Kingsman is on my list, I say to you, you didn't see the movie yet, because it's really good. I've always enjoyed this franchise. Even 2, I thought, had its moments. And then, you know, of course, it pivoted with this entry and became very much a different kind of franchise. But it became something I love even more, because I love Turner Classic Movies, I love history, and I love The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. And this is now basically The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen History Edition. Also, I appreciated the strong anti-war message. Also, the seriousness of sacrifice and responsibility. You know, it's not with great power comes great responsibility like Spider-Man. I would say this is more with great wealth comes responsibility. And I think that the 1% these days doesn't remember that. And so I thought that was very, you know, another element that was very touching. It's got 2 touching elements, the anti-war message and the responsibility of those who have to not only help everybody, but to step up as well. Also, it had amazing action scenes, and a lot of them. A really, really good movie. Matthew Vaughn is very creative. I wonder why he can't get work kind of like outside of his own purview. Maybe he doesn't want to, but you would think some. I mean, I guess he did do the X-Men movies, which weren't as good as the Kingsman movies, so that's weird. All right, so anyway, although some of you, I'm sure, will disagree with that. Number 9, Malignant. How can I not include a movie that nuts on my list? What a viewing experience. Because we went in blind, and our minds were blown. This is, fascinatingly, not the only ode to giallo Italian horror film this year. The other was Last Night in Soho. But that didn't feel like an Edgar Wright movie, that's why I put Malignant on instead. Also because it was just bonkers. It was just knocking futs. But also, it felt very much like James Wan. I think he didn't lose his own identity in making his homage. It was, as I said, an incredible viewing experience. It was just one of the coolest movie-going experiences I've ever had. So, of course, I put it on my list for the year. Number 8, Dune. I know it's not higher up on the list, but that's because the movie's not done. It's just, I feel, you know, just getting started, quite frankly. And I wish they'd filmed the movies back to back, or at least the first 2. But I understand that was a bit too much of a commitment. They weren't sure if it was going to hit, but it's a bit of a shame. Anyway, it was the arrival of Timothée Chalamet into the mainstream, although interestingly, he has a movie on my worst list as well. Although, to be fair, he is one of the best things in it. But, you know, to me, what made Dune stand out the most, I think it's a little weak on the story front, to be honest with you. But to me, what stood out about it the most, besides Timothée Chalamet's really strong performance, was stunning production design and world building. And that, to me, the coolest thing about this movie is that you can still launch a new franchise, even today. You don't have to reach back into the past and revive something. You can get people excited about something new. So I'm excited to see the second film compete in the box office arena without the HBO Max handicap, you know, that it's debuting day and date. I think it can. I mean, it was the biggest debut for a Warner Brothers movie this year under that program, but I'd like to see what it could do if it was theaters only. All right, number 7, Being the Ricardos. That's right, it's higher than Dune, because I love Hollywood, and I love Lucy. This movie I liked it when I first saw it, but it has grown on me. I watched it a second time over the past few days, And I was like, it's really good. I really enjoyed it. This behind-the-scenes story is very interesting. Lots of insight, not just into the characters, but Hollywood, even today. Hollywood then and today. Nicole Kidman had a fascinating comment. This is the importance of going on awards campaign events, because Nicole Kidman was able to add this extra context, which was really interesting. She said that just like Lucille Ball had a problem when she hit 40 in Hollywood way back then, Nicole Kidman said she had the same problem in the movie business, and just like radio and TV saved Lucille Ball, TV saved Nicole Kidman's career. And I thought that was really interesting. Really interesting. Nicole Kidman sure makes a lot of television. But it's great. Very good. I don't usually like the week in a life formula for biographies, but this was the best use of that I've seen. Probably because Aaron Sorkin cheated a little bit with lots of flashbacks and other, very cleverly cheated. I allow it because it was well done. So yeah, I liked this movie, particularly because, again, I liked so many of the elements in it. Number 6, West Side Story. Pretty low down on the list, right? Well, I did enjoy this movie, but the audience disinterest really kind of took the wind out of not only its sales, but the sales of my enthusiasm for it. Now, you might be like, did you like it or not? And that's interesting because, you know, I'm still very enthusiastic. You'll see about some other movies higher up on this list that also didn't do particularly well financially. But, you know, I think what the problem here is that Tony and Maria don't work in this version. They really don't work. To me, this movie was all about Anita, Bernardo, and Riff, and incredible performances from those cast members. And I mean, it is very well updated, it's visually stunning, and I think that Steven Spielberg and Tony Kushner, the director and screenwriter, really did a fantastic job, kind of like making the original more potent, because a lot of the things you couldn't say then, you could say today. And also, they have the hindsight of knowing what happened after the fact, so there's a little bit of a knowing wink in some of the way that Tony Kushner in particular adjusted it. But it seems people really did not want another West Side Story. You know, do they want new stories? Well, In the Heights bombed too. So musicals are really struggling right now, at least at the multiplex. Number 5, King Richard. I love this movie. I love this movie so much. It's not only a great true story about Richard Williams and what he did for his daughters Serena and Venus, but it's also just one of the greatest sports movies I've ever seen, which makes director Ronaldo Marcus Green's work even more impressive because he's hardly made any movies, yet he was able to deliver such a slick professional package, but still with a lot of heart. Now, I know there's some controversy about this movie, with some people asking, why would you make a movie about the Williams sisters and have the focus be their father? Because they're the ones who are so well-known. They're the ones who are famous. Well, the answer is right in the question. Everybody already knows who Serena and Venus Williams are, and they wanted everyone to know who their father is, which I think is just so touching. It's so nice to see great father-daughter relationships, which is another great part of this movie. You know, it's still, to this day, sad to see some fathers disappointed when they hear they're getting a girl. I think it's something that entertainment often promotes, really, unfortunately, in work. I mean, it's so great that The Rock goes around saying hashtag girl dad all the time. And this is the ultimate girl dad story. And you know, it was really just a fabulous movie. And I also have to give a shout out to John Bernthal, who was another big part of why this movie worked so well. Number 4, Spider-Man No Way Home. Now, some of you might be like, that should be number 1, Grace. The movie is not perfect. If it was like The Dark Knight or Joker or even Avengers Endgame, maybe it would be my number 1. But, you know, this is a film critic's list. You know, I also have to tell you, I enjoyed Spider-Man No Way Home quite a bit, but it's not my favorite Marvel movie of the year, a comic book movie of the year, as you're about to find out. I mean, also, I didn't have the experience that many of you had. My critic screening was quiet. As I said, some golf claps, but that's about it. So that, I think, took a little out of the experience. And also, I still feel very strongly that the middle of the movie is more like a Saturday Night Live sketch. A very good one, a very funny Saturday Night Live sketch, an iconic one that has millions of views on YouTube and is unforgettable. But it was an SNL sketch. It wasn't a truly developed story. And I think a lot of that was because of COVID and contract negotiations. I mean, I think they did the best they could, and they're getting rewarded for it handsomely at the box office. Also, in terms of the film itself, it has an incredible beginning and ending. Huge development for Tom Holland's Peter Parker and Zendaya's MJ. Those characters, I think, are the best characters in the movie, even though you have all these other cool characters coming back to play. Very strong finish to a Spider-Man trilogy I've really enjoyed, and a huge turning point for the franchise for sure. I'm very curious to see where it goes next, this franchise. Will it divide? Will they do Andrew Garfield movies? I mean, it's very interesting. I think Spider-Man No Way Home might become an even more important movie in the future. But I mean, it was a really good ride, a fantastic ride. That's why it's number four. No, that's still top five, for Pete's sakes. All right, number three, Shang-Chi. This is my favorite MCU movie of the year. It's just fantastic because it had everything. It was a complete story, and it still managed to have great action. That bus fight scene is the best action scene of the year, hands down. I will fight you about that. I will fight you about that fight scene. Really well done. It's hard to introduce a totally new corner of the MCU so late in the MCU's conception, but Destin Daniel Cretton does it, and he has so many different nuances to this family that we now know. I thought that Zhai Ling is his sister, and you know, the Ten Rings, very interesting. Also, Destin Daniel Cretton fixed the problems from Iron Man 3 and used Ben Kingsley to do it. Now that's a boss move. Also, the father-son relationship really moved me. I cried during this movie. So Tony Leung, he's the GOAT. Fantastic. Then number two, Don't Look Up. The comet in this movie is a giant truth bomb. Adam McKay didn't hold back at all, and I loved every second of it. Extremely insightful, not just about the danger we're in from our planet, from, you know, environment, also works very well with the COVID situation, but also how we're not helping. I mean, that was just really great. And a wonderful, very strong return to form for Jennifer Lawrence, who's coming back to Hollywood after a break. You know, you'll see in my worst list, I talk about a lot of actors who do not have any self-awareness. But Jennifer Lawrence realized she was overexposed, took a break, and I think it was ultimately the right thing to do. And she's coming back right where she left. I would say better than where she left off. I think very strong. And then number one, Nightmare Alley. I just love this movie. I think it's perfect. It's perfect. Another strong commentary on society, a timeless story. This was based on a 1946 novel turned into a 1947 movie. The fact that a geek, and you'll know this when you watch the movie, that a geek is a real thing, is mind-blowing. Talk about, again, human cruelty. This movie is brilliantly written, acted, and filmed. It's the best piece of filmmaking of the year, hands down. That's why it's my number one. It's just a perfect piece of art. Really impressive stuff. So that's my list of the top 10 best movies of 2021. And stay tuned or click right now for that worst list. Share your own thoughts down below and don't forget to subscribe. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.